Hey everyone, it's Cece from One Green Pea. Today I want to talk to you about things your plants would like you to stop doing. The overarching theme of this entire video is that we want to avoid stressing our plants at all costs. Living in our homes is stressful enough for these jungle and desert dwellers, so we don't want to add to that stress and cause them to not live their very best lives. The first thing that your plant wants you to stop doing is something I am terrible about, and that is touching your plant. We have to remember, they are not pets or children, they are plants, and touching them actually stresses them out. I read a recent study that said even the slightest touch by an animal or an insect or the wind or a human causes a gene response in the plant. And what they found was that within 30 minutes of a slight touch, 10% of the plant's genome was affected. And if the touch continues, then the plant growth can be diminished by up to 30%. So we have to stop touching our plants. It's also can cause physical damage. If you look closely, for instance, at this Tradescantia, it's hard to really see on a video, but if you look really closely, there are tiny hairs on the surface of the leaf. And I'm not a botanist, I don't know exactly what purpose they serve, but I know they're important, and I know that when I'm petting, touching, moving my plant around, that I'm damaging, potentially damaging those leaves. So we have to stop. Oh, hey. The second thing we need to stop doing to our plants is moving them. Shifting your plants around leaves a potential for damage, for breaking of stems or of leaves, but it really just boils down again to stressing the plants out. So perhaps you don't shift and move your plants around your room all the time like I do. Maybe you're just trying to move it into an ideal location. It doesn't seem like it's getting enough light or humidity and you're moving it around. That can be really stressful too. Most plants are pretty resilient and they will adapt to most conditions, right, within a general middle ground, let's say, of light and humidity. But if we're constantly moving them into different situations, they're having to adapt, and that's stressful. That takes energy they're not able to put into growth. So we need to stop. The next thing we need to stop doing to our plants is leaving them in the dark. I know, you read on the internet or on the plant care tag that your plant can tolerate low light. Well, low light does not mean no light. So if you have a place that you would like to put your plant that has no natural light or very low natural light, like a top shelf or a windowless office or a bathroom, you have to invest in grow lights. You have to understand that a plant needs light for photosynthesis. And so even a plant like an Epipretum aureum or a Pothos can tolerate low light, it doesn't prefer it, and it's not going to have ideal growth in that situation. So we have to stop keeping our plants in the dark. Speaking of photosynthesis, brings me to the next thing you have to stop doing to your plants, and that is letting them accumulate dust. Now, I know I don't like dusting, but for photosynthesis, that very vital life process of a plant, they need a clear leaf surface. How do you do it? Well, for a really sturdy plant like this snake plant, what I would do is just take a soft cloth and wipe down both surfaces of the leaves. Now, if your plant has horizontal leaves, then you really only need to dust off the top because that's the only place that the dust will settle. If you have a plant with more delicate leaves, then instead of a cloth, you might choose to use either like a really soft facial brush or even a paintbrush. So we need to stop letting dust accumulate on our plants. The next thing we need to stop doing to our plants is repotting too often. Repotting is one of my favorite plant tasks. I love it. I get to take the plant out and look at the roots and give it a fresh new pot, a new home, new soil. And I just feel like I'm doing something and I'm going to create new growth and the plant's going to get bigger and thrive. It'll be awesome. But there are several reasons that's not a great idea to do all the time. The first reason comes back to my original premise, and that is stress. Repotting a plant is very stressful. You're literally taking it up and out of its home, disturbing the roots, potentially disturbing the stems, the leaves, all the parts of the plant. And that's not necessarily a good idea. It's also not a great idea because if you put a plant in a pot that's too big for the root structure, then you have a very high likelihood of overwatering the plant. And that is because as you water, the soil absorbs the moisture, and a bigger pot means more soil, which means more moisture. And so the little root system isn't big enough to absorb all of that water, so the water stays in the soil. And then the roots basically stay in wet soil. And they don't like that, and they suffocate and die. Not a good idea. Okay, so how do you know when it's time to repot? There are a couple of rules of thumb that I personally use. One of them is when the plant just looks crowded, when you look inside and there are stems all over the place and it looks crowded, like my Monstera adansonii does in here. Another way to tell is to look at the bottom of the pot. And if you see roots coming out of the bottom, which I do, then that's another sign that the root system is big and it's searching for more space. And the third way that I know it's time to repot is when I water the plant and the water runs through very quickly. That means that the root mass is so large that there's not a lot of soil left to absorb that moisture. And that is happening with my Monstera. And so it's time to up-pot this guy. What we need to stop doing is repotting too soon or too often. The last two things that I want to mention that we need to stop doing for our plants kind of run in together. The first one is we need to stop taking credit or blame for their lives. Plants are extremely resilient and have a life force that we don't even fully understand. And so while we can give them the very best conditions possible and everything that we possibly know what to do for a plant, sometimes they just don't thrive. Take my Calathea, for instance, just has not been a great successful plant for me. And, you know, I've made some mistakes, but I've really done my very best to nurture this plant. And, you know, sometimes plants thrive in spite of our neglect and our mistakes. So it's not about us all the time. So we need to stop taking credit or blame for their lives. And then the last item is that perhaps we need to stop loving our plants so much. And maybe by loving, I mean putting our sense of self-worth in the condition of our plants or the size of our plant collection or the rarity of the species that we collect. Plant collection, plant care, it's a wonderful hobby and I am fully absorbed in it in my life. But I also have to understand that sometimes plants die. And sometimes I need to put a plant out of my misery. And it's okay to reduce my plant count by one, or just maybe the amount of stress that I have in my plant collecting, my plant care, my plant hobby. This Calathea wurzewicziae has just honestly been on the struggle bus since about week two of my owning it. And we're a couple years into this relationship. I have committed him to the compost bin numerous times, but then he shoots out a leaf like, hey, don't forget about me, I'm still here. So I struggle on with this guy, but honestly, it's okay with me. He's gonna do what he's gonna do, and I'm okay with that. Thank you for watching my video about what we need to stop doing for our plants. Before you go, if you would remember to give my video a thumbs up and subscribe if you're not already subscribed. And if you know someone who would appreciate this content, feel free to share. I love your comments. I love knowing you're along on this plant journey with me. Until next time, my plant friends, let's keep growing together a greener world.